All right, so we want to start with this new lesson today. It's called, guys, ratios and proportions. I know, sounds weird, in particular, proportions. Whoa. There it is. Okay. So, what is it really all about? Before I start this, I need you to understand why we're learning this, ratio and proportion. You might ask me, well, what do I have to learn this for? What is it being used in real life? How am I going to ever use ratio and proportion in real life, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll give you three scenarios that can be used, how you're going to use it in real life. Pretend that you're going to be doing a headcount in your company of like 5,000 employees. Let's say that. Your boss gave you this task to work on, and he said, you have exactly 1 hour to tell me how many females do we have at our work site and how many males do we have at our work site, boys and girls, basically separated. The only information that he gives you is, we have 5,000 employees spread all over campus. It's like a really big campus, and the only other information is, he said, well, for every two females, I have three male. That's the only thing he gives you. So for every two female workers, I have three male workers. This is 5,000 employees. And you're gonna sit there and say, oh my gosh, I'm gonna go to every single department and start counting each. You're female, I'm gonna mark you down. You're female. You know, are you gonna do that?
No.
In 1 hour, not gonna happen. So,
we'll tell us to get a number.
Okay.
I know the answer.
Wait. That's what ratio and proportion will come in to help you. Okay, that's one first whole scenario. We're going to talk about that. We're going to tackle that scenario and see how it's going to be solved. So remember that for me. Second scenario. If you've ever done any cooking in your life,
yes.
You know you need a recipe, right?
Uh-huh.
And usually, what does it say on a recipe? Excuse me.
Sorry.
What does it say on the recipe? Usually, you need 2 cups of sugar, 3 cups of flour, whatever, or to make this many portions. So let's say that you need 2 cups of sugar to make 10 pies. What if your portion now, you need to make like 5,000 pies? Are you gonna just go in there and say, okay, gosh, how am I gonna measure this now? You know? So, but then again, you need a way to calculate it, and once again, ratio and proportion will come to your rescue. They will help you resolve that particular problem. A third scenario that I wanna bring up to share with you is, if you're into building houses, construction for whatever reason, or designing a new car, where do you think you're going to start designing your car or designing your house or a new building?
On a piece of paper.
On a piece of paper or on a computer, is that true? And a computer, as you know, is only as big as your, 15, 16 inches or 20 inches wide? It only contains so much, right? You can't not fit an actual physical house into a computer. You have is an actual a drawing of the house. What you see on the computer is being what? Scaled down from an actual version of it. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. That, so when you say model car versus actual car, it's a scaled down version. Well, guess what? Ratio and proportions again. Because now, when you say the scale model is 1 to 18, that means for every 1 inch that you see, for example, it's actually about 18 feet in real life, for example. That's what it's representing. Same thing on your map. You see your map on usually on the lower left-hand corner with a legend. It says like kilometers and miles, and it's only that long. And in real life, you know how long is a mile? Really long, right? You've run a mile before.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to run a mile?
Like six minutes.
If you're fast, it takes you about 5 minutes, but it's still a pretty long distance, isn't it? But on the map, it's only like 1 inch. You know what I'm saying? So that is a scaled down version of it. And once again, how do we use to calculate the lake from your house to your friend's house on a map? Ratio and proportion once again. So at least I'm trying to convince you that, hey, there is a good use for ratio and proportion here. And you really want to learn how to do this. So let's tackle our first problem, the employee problem, males versus female problem. We have 5,000 employees, and the only information we know is that it's a 2-to-3 ratio. Well, I just talked about ratio, and let's talk about what it really means. Here's your first word that you need to know.
Ratio.
What does it mean? Or I should say that. Well, a ratio is just a comparison between two things.
Two numbers by division.
Okay, and we have three ways to represent our ratios. Three ways. First of all, like you said, by division, fraction. So remember I told you about the male to female ratio? Your boss said this. The boss said that for every two females at our work site, we have three male employees. A 2-to-3 ratio. That's what it means. So when I say two female to three male, 2-to-3. Another way to represent ratio is by using the colon. There. You need to know what two represent, what three represent. This is called the base ratio. Okay? That means it's simplified completely. You cannot break it down any further. It's called base ratio. And another way to represent a ratio is by using the word two. Two, there. So three different ways to represent your ratio. Any question how to represent your ratio? Are we clear with that?
Yeah.
Okay. Notice here, even though I separate the males and the females, but as a group, they're all employees, right? Is that true? They're workers. How many workers are in each group?
Five.
So meaning for every five workers in a group, we expect to have how many females and how many males? Two females and three males. So let me ask you this next question, based on the ratio of 2-to-3, okay? Still on the same ratio. What if I have 15 workers? How many females and how many male figures will I have?
6 females and 9 males.
Okay, well, you kind of think about this. 2 females, 3 males. 4 females, 6 males. 6 females, 9 males. You see how that works? Notice, look, so that means out of 15 workers, I would have 6 females and 9 males. But look, 6 plus 9 is 15. And if you take 6 over 9, is that reduced to also 2/3? Two-thirds?
Yep, sir.
Does this make sense? Okay, now, any questions so far? How's this gonna help us with the 5,000 employees, right? So watch, we need to get you started with, first of all, finding the proportion by introducing what we call equivalent ratios. What does it mean? Watch this. Notice I said 6/9 is the same thing as 2/3, why?
Because
yeah, you can simplify 6/9 down to 2/3. What if I just ask you to figure out this? Oh man. Okay, what if I ask you to do this? Here's 2/3. Here's my question. If I have another fraction that looks like this right here, 16 and 18, for example, I ask you to verify. Are these two equivalent? How do you verify they're equivalent or not? Yes, Vince. You can simplify the 16 over 18, right? Or what if I don't want to simplify? Is there another way to figure out whether or not they're equivalent? Yes. You can.
I know.
Or what is it?
Multiply by 6.
You just find the same denominator?
LCD.
Okay, LCD, fine. Or, like I said, the other quick way to do it is to cross multiply. So watch this. 18 times 2?
36.
36. And 3 times 16?
48.
Are they equal?
No.
No. So that means they're not equivalent. What should I change here? What should I change here to make it equivalent? What should 16 be to make it equivalent to 2/3? 12. Very good. So if I have 2/3 and 12 over 18, now, if you test it again, watch what happened. I have 36, I have 36. Oh, they're the same. So therefore, you can conclude that 2/3 is the same thing as 12 over 18. They are proportional. So when you have two ratios that are equal to each other, we can also call that proportional. Yes?
Could you simplify 16?
Yes, you can also simplify that to verify. I'm saying this is just another way to do it. And cross multiplying is another way. Okay, are we clear on that part so far?
Yeah.
So let's go back and figure out how do we solve this employee problem. We have 5,000 workers. Oh. I have 5,000 workers right here. And I need to figure out how many females, how many males. The only thing I know is that for every two females, I have three males, right? That's all I know. For every two females, I have three males. But overall, I have 5,000 workers. How am I going to figure out how many females, how many males? Well, if you think about it this way, That means for every 5 workers, we talked about this before. How many females will I have for every 5 workers?
Two.
Two. Okay, so is this a ratio? Two female to every 5 worker? So all we need to do is find another equivalent ratio, and we will have our answer. Well, what is their equivalent ratio? Watch what happened. Set up a proportion. We have 5 workers. This is a smaller group, and this is a bigger group. So all I have to do is compare the smaller group to the larger group. 5 worker to 5,000 workers. And here, up here, what am I trying to find in this group? Females, right? So let's define F of females. And there you have it. We have ourselves a proportion. Watch. F over 5,000 equals to 2 over 5. See? How do we solve for F? How do we solve for F? You cross multiply. There you have it. You cross multiply, you have 5F equals to 10,000, right? Divided by 5 both sides. F is, what is 10,000, sorry, what is 10,000 divided by 5?
2,000.
So look, I have 2,000 female workers, and how many males workers will I have in this company?
3,000.
There you go. That's how you figure out that problem. But notice that the important thing is that you have to set up your ratio correctly. Workers has to deal with worker. You know, whatever unit that you're dealing with has to be at the same level. Okay? Now, if that doesn't make sense yet, let's do another scenario that I mentioned before. Let's use a scenario involving cooking this time. Let's take a look at this. One right here. If I need two cups of flour to make, if I need 2 cups of flour to make 5 pies, okay, let's say that. How many cups of sugar do you think I would need in order to make 450 pies? Okay, now you can sit here and just calculate, okay, 2 cups of 5 pies, so 4 cups for 10 pies, and so on, right? It'll take you a while. Instead of doing something like that, what you should have done is start setting up a proportion. First of all, look at your base ratio. It's 2 cups of flour for every, 5 pies. So then, that is your structure, right? All you have to do is get another group. What information do I have on the other side already? How many pies do I need to make? 450. Where do you think I would put the 450? Up top and the bottom. See, you see why I have to label this to show you that, the cups are on top, the flour's on top, the pie's on the bottom. So 450 pie will be in the bottom. What do I need to put on top here? Cups of what?
Flour.
So it's not defined yet, right? So can I just say flour for F? So F is, so when I say define a variable, you say F is the cups of flour I need to make 450 pies. Now how do I solve this problem? There you go. So you see, the end result is always cross-multiply. So here we go. We cross-multiply. We have 5F equals to 900, right? Because 450 times 2 divided by 5. F is 1, okay, 180 cups. So that means to make this big number pie, 450 pies, you need 180 cups of flour. Yes?
Why did you put 5 pies and then 450 pies?
No, I'm saying this is the base unit. To make two 5 pies, I need 2 cups. My question is, what if I want to make 450
so that's
pies?
Like a formula or like the ratio?
This is like the base ratio. I will always give you this. Okay? And then I say, what if I want to make this much? How many cups do you need? Yes?
Would there ever be a problem where we actually need a 5 base ratio?
If that's the case, then I will give you the other information. So it's one or the other. The opposite, right. Here's the last scenario I want to give you. Excuse me. One more scenario. Let's do the map scenario, right? Want to do that? Okay. So here is the map. I want to take a look at this here. If you look at the map, you probably see something like this. And it says, this right here, this distance is about 2 kilometers for every 1 inch that you see on your map. Let's say that. So every 1 inch on your map, in actual life, is 2 kilometers, okay? So here's a map, for example. This is your house, and this is your friend's house. This is your friend, and this is you, okay? You measure it from here to here. Okay, let's say it's about 12 inches. And you want to figure out how long is that in real life. Then, guess what? You use the base scenario, 1 inch for every 2 kilometers. Set it up. So now, I want to find out how many kilometers in 12 inches, right? Where do I put the 12 inch? Top or bottom?
Bottom.
Think about this. Where do I put the inch?
Oh.
You see that? You look at the unit that you put here. Where did I specify my inch? On top. Because I give you inch, then you put it on top, right? So 12 inch right here. And the kilometers I'm trying to find, so I'm just going to say distance for D in kilometers. And there you have it. You have yourself a proportion once again. How do I solve this? There you go. You cross, multiply. Okay? And so you will have 1 times D is just 1D. 2 times 12 is?
24.
24 what?
Inches. Okay. Wait,
what? What are we finding?
Kilometers.
D is in what unit? Kilometers. You need to know your units here. There it is. So that means 12 inches on the map. In actual life, in actual reality, it is 24 kilometers apart. There. This is the third scenario using proportion and ratio. Notice I'm using the base ratio. I put the ratio and match it up or setting up a proportion to solve for the missing whatever value.
Why can't you just do it 12 times?
I know, but I'm saying, what if this is not as simple as 1 to 2? What if it's like 5.2 to 6.7? You know, you can't do it like that.
No, use
the Alicia, I'm trying to show you the technique. You see it? This will work for any case. Is that clear? Okay. So that's it, guys. This will be up for you.